Professor Thangadurais from Harishchandra Research Institute. He works in number theory, combinatorics, and many other areas. And he's the one of the leading expert in India. So, today he is talking about trace of powers of an algebraic number. So, sir, you can start now.
Okay. Thank you, Akhilesh, for a nice introduction. I am thankful to the organizer for giving me opportunity for this 75th birthday conference of Michel Waldschmidt. Since student time, I know Professor Michel Waldschmidt as a teacher and a motivator. I hope he lives 100 years plus he helps us more. So, okay, I'll start my talk. I dedicate this talk, it's an ongoing work. It's not completed yet, but I thought I will present some new work to Michel. This is just an ongoing work. The title of the talk is Trace of Powers of an Algebraic Number. I'll start with the history. Okay. So in this 1915, Polya, and then later proved by Lenstra and Ponomaro. Polya proved using Fatou's lemma. What he proved is if a given algebraic number alpha, which is an algebraic integer, if and only if the trace of alpha power n is integer for all natural numbers n. Okay. Then in 1993, but it's a finite version. D. Smith proved a finite version of this result in the following sense. If alpha is an algebraic number of degree D, if the trace of alpha power n is integer for all n equal to 1, 2, 3, up to this range, finite range, depending only on the degree D, then alpha is an algebraic integer. Okay, so Polya asked post one more question in the literature. It is a question of John Lame. So what is the question? Question is if alpha is an algebraic number of degree D, and the trace of alpha power n is integer for infinitely many natural numbers, then whether alpha necessarily an algebraic integer or not. Okay. It's that type of question. Instead of all integers or consecutively finite block of integers, we are asking for infinitely many powers of alpha, the trace whose trace is integer, whether does it imply that it's algebraic integer. Okay. So in 2004, Korvaja and Zanier, while proving their Ross theorem on moving target to solve a problem of Mahler, they addressed this question. It comes in between because this result is also used in order to prove that main result. Okay, so what they proved is that if alpha is an algebraic number and E is an infinite subset of natural numbers, for each n, suppose there exists a positive integer qn such that it is not much, the growth is not like log of qn divided by n, which is the limit is zero. It means we are controlling the magnitude of qn. Okay. Then if the trace of qn alpha power n is non-zero integer, for this infinitely many values of n, then what they proved is this alpha is either a hth root of rational number of a positive integer h, or it's an algebraic integer. Okay. So in this, if alpha has a denominator, suppose alpha is an algebraic number, it means d of alpha is the denominator. I could have multiplied by d of alpha times alpha, which is an algebraic integer, Then I took whole power, any power n, then d power n times alpha power n is always trace is going to be integer. But the point is the limit. If we take this limit log of d of alpha power n divided by n is d of alpha, which is non-zero. So it should not be like d of alpha, something smaller. That's what here main thing. Okay, this is related to that infinitely many. This proof, of course, uses somewhat funny. This proof uses the Schmidt's subspace theorem. Later, using the techniques of Kuroja and Zanier, Filippo and Purushottam Rath, they proved it. This work appeared very recently in JNT. This what they proved is, if alpha and lambda are algebraic numbers such that the trace of lambda times alpha power n is a non-zero integer for infinitely many natural numbers, then alpha must be an algebraic integer. Okay, which is kind of that question of Lehm proved in general with multiplication of alpha lambda. Okay. In this, I'm using some different. Okay. So while proving this result, Filippo and Rath, what they proved one more result, interesting result. Okay. That says alpha is a non-zero algebraic number and K is the algebraic closure of Q of alpha. If H is the order of the torsion group of K star, it means the root number of roots of unity in K star, H. Okay. If the trace of alpha power n, where the trace is taken over K over Q of alpha power H. Okay. This trace is zero for infinitely many natural numbers n, then there is one particular value. This has to be, the trace has to be zero. That value is A is lying between 1 to H minus 1. Okay. So this interesting result they proved while classifying for the trace of alpha power n is zero for when, then, if and only if alpha where it lies. Okay. They give a kind of necessary and sufficient condition. Okay, for our discussion, of course, we need these two results. That's why I'm just stating it here. Our first main result is the finite version. We could extend the result of D. Smith in the following sense. Okay, let alpha 1 be a non-zero algebraic number, and alpha 2, alpha k be all the other conjugates, Calva conjugates of alpha 1. For some integer k, let k be the Galois closure of q of alpha 1, and the degree is d. The degree of k over q is d. Then take any integers b1, b2, bk such that the sum is non-zero. We call it little n. Little n is nothing but the sum of this given integers. If the trace of the linear combination of bi alpha I power j, okay, the trace of bi, the sum of bi alpha I power j is integer for all j in the finite strip, similar to D. Smith, with the interval is now it's bigger depending on the n. N is nothing but the sum of the integers b1, b2, bk. Here maybe modulus value of n we should have written in this. Okay, the range is 1, 2, 3 up to d plus d times log 2 of modulus of n times d, then plus 1. If this many values, this kind of linear recurrence sequence, if it is trace is integers, then alpha must be an algebraic integer, of course. So is alpha j's. This is the first result. So we have got a natural kind of extension, natural corollary, when we take b1 to be q, any integer natural number, and rest of the bi's are zero, then this corollary, this theorem will state as follows. Oops, it's not funny. Okay, this theorem states, let alpha be a non-zero algebraic number of degree k greater than or equal to 2. Let k be the Galois closure of q of alpha of degree d. If the trace of alpha power j is not just integer, but fixed, fixed denominator, rational number for this interval, the same interval, then also we can conclude that alpha is an algebraic integer. Okay. So this is the first corollary. I am not using this Acrobat. That is the reason it is kind of giving trouble. Sorry. Okay, we could generalize this just the way of the Purushottam Rath and Philippon's result. Alpha is a given non-zero algebraic number of degree k, and k is the Galois, capital K is the Galois closure of q of alpha of degree d. Lambda is a non-zero element of k. The trace of lambda is, suppose the trace of lambda is, it's going to be a rational number, a by b, we just fix a and b. What is the result? The result is that trace of lambda alpha j is kind of fixed denominator rational numbers. Here fixed denominator is q for this range of powers, j equal to 1, 2, 3 up to d plus d into log 2 of dq modulus value of ab plus 1 for some integer q, then also we can able to say alpha is an algebraic integer. So the similar setup, here we were trying to prove the kind of linear recurrence. Bi's are fixed and alpha 1, alpha 2, alpha j's are unfortunately conjugate, Galois conjugates. It would have been nicer if we would have proved for given alpha 1, alpha 2, alpha k, but the technique will not go through. We are forced to take kind of Galois conjugates of alpha 1, the rest of the alpha is also. So the same question one can ask in the infinite setup, which will use the Smith surface theorem. Still, that is not done yet. What we could prove is the following. Okay, let alpha is a non-zero algebraic number, which is not a root of unity, and lambda is a non-zero algebraic number. We take L to be the Q attached with alpha and lambda, be the number field, K be the Galois closure of L, H is the order of the torsion subgroup of the multiplicative group K star. Okay, and assume that the trace of lambda alpha power a, trace of lambda alpha power a is non-zero for all integers in the finite strip 0 to h minus 1. We don't want that infinitely many trace, it has to be 0. Okay, so from the Purushottam Philippon results, this finite interval will come. Okay, then for any given rational number p by q, there are at most finitely many natural numbers n satisfying this kind of Diophantine equation. The trace of lambda alpha power n equal to p by q. Okay. So this is the first result which is needed to prove the next one. Okay. So if k is, suppose in this theorem, if we take k is a totally real field, k is the Galois closure of L, if it is k is totally real, then the torsion group is H, the order of the torsion group is 2. Therefore, we can deduce this result in a simpler form. Okay, this is the way. If K is a totally real Galois extension over Q, then alpha is not equal to plus minus 1, because alpha, we are avoiding the root of unity. The trace is non-zero. Then also we have this. in simple terms, this Diophantine equation has only finitely many solution. Okay, the trace Diophantine equation. Okay, this is needed. Okay, this is needed in term to prove the following theorem. I am just showing the theorem, then I will come back to this argument. Okay, this is the general theorem. So let alpha and lambda be the given non-zero algebraic numbers, and L is the field containing smallest field containing lambda and alpha, and K be the Galois closure, little h is the order of the torsion subgroup of K star. Suppose the same condition, the trace of lambda alpha power A is non-zero for this finite strip 0 to h minus 1 for all A. Then if we have, suppose trace of lambda alpha power n is a rational number, fixed denominator rational number, with the denominator is q for infinitely many natural numbers n, then alpha is an algebraic integer. In order to prove this, first we had to do this kind of Diophantine equation problem, then we could deduce this. Okay, that's the way we wanted to do this particular theorem. So for that we needed that Diophantine result. Okay, so I'll come back to this. First we will prove the finite result D. Smith, in the same spirit as D. Smith. Okay, the what finite result the linear recurrence. So I'll go back to, sorry, today is not very much organized. Okay, so first our result is, this is the result. We will give a complete proof. Okay, alpha 1 is the given non-zero algebraic number, and alpha 2, alpha k are the other Galois conjugates of alpha 1. K is the algebraic closure of q of alpha 1 and of degree d. Suppose b1, b2, bk are integers, given integers, whose sum is n and it is non-zero. If the trace of this linear recurrence for the finite powers only, so for all j in this range, if the trace is integer, then alpha is an algebraic integer. This is what we are going to prove. Okay. Okay, so first we have to we want to prove something. Alpha is a given algebraic number satisfying some condition. We want to prove it is algebraic integer with whatever assumption. The condition should imply that algebraic integer. So basically we want to prove it is in alpha is integral over integer. This integrality is a local phenomenon. So that is well known. For the sake of completion, I have written just a few lines proof. If K is a number field, OK is a ring of integers. OK is nothing but the intersection of all the localization of a ring of integers at the prime ideals. So therefore, if I want to prove alpha belongs to OK, it is enough to show that alpha belongs to all the localization at the prime ideal. So therefore, by tensoring with the QP, the field of periodic integers, it is enough to prove alpha is integral over ZP for all prime number. This is the way we are going to prove. We want to prove alpha is a given number, algebraic number, and we want to prove it is algebraic integer. So instead of that, what we are going to do is the same condition we are going to assume, but alpha is not integral over, alpha belongs to QP, and it's alpha is an algebraic element over QP, and we want to prove that alpha is integral element over ZP. That's what we want to prove. Okay, say with under the same condition, similar condition, but in the setup of periodic integers. Okay, So let me, so the therefore, in order to prove theorem one, it is enough to prove for any rational number, rational prime p, alpha 1 is an algebraic element over qp of degree k, alpha 2, alpha k be the other Galois conjugates of alpha, b1, b2, bk are given integers such that b1 plus b2 plus bk equal to n, which is non-zero integer. Okay. Oops, it's not visible. What's up? Completely. Okay, so the let k be the Galois closure of qp of alpha. I don't know whether it is visible or not. It's not visible here. Okay, so k be the Galois closure of qp of alpha of degree d, and we are going to assume that same condition, the trace of alpha 1 b1 alpha 1 power j plus b2 alpha 2 power j, etc., bk alpha k power j is inside zp for all j in that finite strip. Okay, then we want to prove that alpha is integral over zp. That's the kind of translation we have done. Okay, so in order to prove this periodic version, we need some basic lemmas. The first lemma says if alpha is integral over zp, and we look at the characteristic polynomial of alpha, here the characteristic polynomial is over k over k, it is going to come. So f of x is nothing but x power d. I mean, the characteristic polynomial, suppose if it is like x power d plus ad minus 1, x power d minus 1, etc., with the coefficients coming from zp, then yes, the coefficients are going to lie in the maximal ideal, unique maximal ideal PZP. Okay, that's the basic lemma, first lemma, which we need. The second lemma we need is, okay, this is inside the proof it will come. Just I am stating it, and then in the proof, naturally it will come. Let P be a given prime number. K is a finite Galois extension over QP of degree D. Suppose alpha is an element in K, such that alpha is not in the local ring. Okay, so here I have written like OK, but it's a local ring of K, and beta is a Galois conjugate of alpha. So B1, B2 are two given periodic integers such that B1 plus B2 is non-zero. Then what this lemma says, for each integer L, okay, for each integer L, if I look at this combination, linear combination of this alpha powers and beta powers, B1 alpha L plus 1 plus B2 alpha B2 times beta power L plus 1, etc., up to D numbers, if I construct, then one of the numbers will be always non-zero. For any given L, one of the numbers of this form will be non-zero. That's all it says. The proof is also by induction. One can prove when L equal to 0, the assumption L equal to 0, if you see that the assumption itself will give us kind of, okay. So the proof will, one can prove by induction. Okay, so we will get into the proof of the theorem. Okay, so we are assuming that k, the alpha is of degree k, alpha 1 is of degree k, that's the reason we looked at all the Galois conjugates of alpha I, or alpha 1 is like alpha 1, alpha 2, alpha k, and b1, b2, bk are given integers. So in order to prove this, the another reduction is that it is enough to assume k equal to 2 in that sense. So it means you rest b3 onwards, you assume 0. B1, B3, B4, etc., BK is 0, and B1 plus B2 is equal to N, non-zero. The general proof will be verbatim, okay? General case. So it is enough to prove just for two. I mean, alpha and beta are the two Galois conjugates, complete set of Galois conjugates, and then it comes, okay? So assume that, so we want to prove alpha 1 is integral over ZP. Suppose not, contradiction method. So alpha 1 is not integral over ZP, and so is alpha 2 because of its Galois conjugate. So then we let gamma 1 is the inverse of alpha 1 and gamma 2 is the inverse of alpha 2, which are integral over Zp. Okay, so then the then we take the characteristic polynomial of gamma 1 and gamma 2. Both the characteristic polynomial is same because these two are Galois conjugates. Okay, this characteristic polynomial will satisfy the lemma 1. It means the coefficients, the except the leading coefficient is going to be 1 because it is integral. The rest of the coefficients lie in the maximal ideal, unique maximal ideal of Zp, Pzp. Okay, so, okay, I'm just writing gamma 1. So since we don't need to take alpha 1, alpha 2, I'm taking alpha and beta, just for simplicity. So and the unique maximal ideal, I take it to be capital P, okay, of Zp, just for simplicity. Okay, so alpha inverse and beta inverse is an integral over Zp and it satisfies the characteristic polynomial. Just therefore, we will get this equation. Okay, it satisfies this and therefore we get this equation 1. So what we do, we multiply for each integer L greater than or equal to 0, we multiply the powers alpha power d plus L, both sides. And similarly, beta power d plus L, both sides. We have two equations in one. So we just multiply what to get alpha power L. We can write in terms of is as a linear combination of alpha power L plus 1 to alpha power L plus d, with coefficients A is coming from the maximal ideal P. Okay, similarly beta L. Okay, so this is true for all integer L. So what we are going to construct, we are going to construct a module generated by some set of elements. Okay, so for each integer L, we take ML to be the Zp submodule of K spanned by this particular elements of D. L is fixed and we are taking D elements of this form, B1 alpha L plus 1 plus B2 beta L plus 1, etc. Then B1 alpha L plus D plus B2 beta L plus D. Okay, the we generate Zp module, submodule of K spanned by this. Spanned by this ML is the Zp submodule of K. For each L we have such, and if this is non-zero, this okay, by that lemma we can say, make sure that ML is a non-zero submodule, that is we need it. Okay, so this two, I mean alpha power L, we could write in terms of linear combination of alpha power L plus 1 to alpha power L plus D. So it, and similarly beta power L also we could rewrite. So this means that, okay, this means that B1 times alpha power L plus B2 times beta power L lie in the submodule, product module, the P times ML. Because coefficients, just I'm multiplying from the equation 2 by B1, equation 3 by B2, and I'm adding it up. When I add up this, always the, all the coefficients are going to lie inside that maximal ideal P. So therefore, I can capture this particular B1 alpha power L plus B2 beta power L lie in this module, product module, for each L. Okay, note that, okay, so next is, I have a kind of series of modules, several modules. So for each L, I have a ML module. So whether this is kind of increasing or not, that's what it says. For each non-negative integers L1, L2, if L1 is less than L2, then ML1, ML1 is contained in ML2. Oh, this is again not visible here.
It's visible.
Okay, so in my thing it's not visible. Okay, okay, so our aim is to, what is our aim? Okay, so we have just constructed a module, and we are capturing something inside the product module, something submodule. Okay, some elements, particular elements for each L, B1 alpha power L plus B2 beta power L inside the submodule. Okay, B times ML. Okay, this is okay. So the main claim is that for each L and for each integer k, each non-negative integer k, this b1 alpha power l plus b2 beta power l lie inside this p power k plus 1 times l plus dkth module m. Okay, this of course from the previous observation ml is contained in ml ml plus 1 etc. From this it doesn't follow, because we are multiplying by, I mean, the this module can be much smaller compared to ml dk, ml plus dk, l plus dk. Okay, so therefore that this particular b1 alpha power l plus b2 beta power l belongs to p times ml, that may not imply this, even though in the module wise some kind of inclusion is there. We need to prove this. Okay, when for any l and k, when k equal to 0, if you see, that is precisely we have proved for k equal to 0. This equation 4 says that k equal to 0 l for any l we have proved. Okay, that's the statement. Now we want to prove for any k also, for any l, this is going to be true. This statement is going to be true. Okay. Okay. So if when l is any non-negative integer and k is 0, we are done. So we assume that result is true for l and for some integer k. We prove for k plus 1. Result is true for l. And for some integer k, it means b1 alpha power l plus b2 beta power l belongs to the p power k plus 1 times m l plus dk. Okay, we want to prove it for dk plus 1, I mean k plus 1. It means k is replaced by k plus 1. So the same thing, p power k plus 2 times m l plus d times k plus 1. The same for every L, this should be inside. Okay, another power of P goes up. So, okay, how it is? The proof is, okay, so for each I in between the strip, because you see each ML is spanned by ML plus 1, the powers, the exponent, if you see L plus 1, L plus 2, L plus D. Okay, ML means L plus 1, L plus 2, L plus D, that powers of elements is spanning. Okay, so for each I, what we have is precisely this. B1 alpha power I plus B2 beta power I belongs to this, because, okay, this is already inside. This contains this as a spanning. Okay, this is clear, but B1 alpha power I plus B2 beta power I lie inside P times MI, that is coming from 4 already. This is true. Okay, I will just show. This is lie inside P times MI. Why it is? Okay, P times ML for any L. Okay, any L, this is true, that is 4. And 5 is if L ML is contained in ML plus 1, that is 5. Therefore, this inequality is true. I is bigger than this is okay for all integers. This this is coming, that the next inequality, the inclusion is coming from mi is contained in ml plus d times k plus 1. That is the reason I is less than or equal to l plus d times k plus 1. Therefore, the last inclusion is coming. This is true for all. Therefore, hence we get, somehow, I am sorry, today my thing is not visible. Okay. So, by induction hypothesis, we know this. This particular linear combination lies in the p power k plus 1 times m of l plus dk. So, p power k plus 1 times m of l plus dk, the m of l plus dk is contained in p. The previous slide, what it's supposed to give is, I don't know how far it is visible. Okay, it's supposed to give is m l plus, the one more multiplication of p should come. So m l plus dk, is contained in p, contained in p times m l plus d plus k plus 1. Okay, so that will tell you this, that's what the previous line is. Okay, so using that, this comes. Okay, this is what actually we wanted to prove. So using this statement, now we can finish the proof. Okay, this is the technical part. Rest is, this statement is true for any L and any K. We can choose K as we like and L as we like. So to finish the proof, what we are going to take, L is 0 and K is like, B1 is given integer, B2 is given integer and D is given integer. So therefore, we can take this maximum power of P. The P is a given prime number. Maximum power of P, we just take as K. Okay. So using this, for this K and L, we apply this the result, the claim. By hypothesis, what happens? What is the assumption? Assumption, it says, you see, the alpha, the all the linear combination, the trace is going to lie inside ZP for all the exponents like I equal to 1, 2, 3 up to D plus D times log of B1 plus B2 times D, logarithm base 2. Okay, this is up to that many exponents one can, the trace is lying inside ZP. That is same as, see this DD block. So if you look at this particular M of this module, whatever we have constructed, the module of A minus D, where A is in this range, suppose, then the trace of any element in this module is contained in ZP. That's what the hypothesis implies. The hypothesis and the constructed module implies this. Okay. So since K is the maximum power of P appearing in the integer B1 plus B2 times D. Okay. So, but since log base 2 is, it says that maximum power of 2 lies inside. Therefore, D times K should be strictly less than D times log 2 of B1 plus B2 times D plus 1. Okay. So, therefore, we can take A to be in that, that A to be D plus DK, so that we get that trace of MK, the module, any element of that, any element element of trace of any element in that module MDK is inside ZP. Okay. So when L equal to 0, what happens? B1 plus B2, this is same as B1 plus B1 times alpha power L. This is nothing but the, this is what, which is lie inside P power K plus 1 MDK. So we see that its traces, when we take the trace completely, then we take, we get B1 plus B2 times D, and this lies inside the trace of that module. Already we have seen that trace of MDK is lies inside ZP, and the trace of any element of p power k plus 1, the little p power k plus 1 will come out. Okay, so therefore this b1 plus b2 times d will lie inside p power k plus 1 zp, this ideal. Okay, this means that the power of p dividing b1 plus b2 times d is at least k plus 1, which is a contradiction. That's the way we get a contradiction. This is because of the assumption and because of this particular, okay, this is the claim. Okay, oops, last portion somehow in this it's not visible. Okay, so the contradiction is because we assume that alpha is not integral, alpha 1 is not integral, now therefore alpha is integral over z. Okay, somehow I messed it up because this is not an acrobat, it is not visible to me, unfortunately. Okay, this is the other finiteness result, similar the same module technique. I will get into the infinite version which uses the Schmitt subspace theorem. Okay, so first we recall the general preliminaries. K is a number field of which is Galois over Q with the Galois group, Galois of K over Q. MK be the set of inequivalent places of K. M infinity is the set of all Archimedean places. For each place V, absolute value is denoted by usual way, which is normalized with respect to K. And for any infinite place, there is an automorphism sigma in the Galois group, such that for all x in k we define, again it is not visible, we normalize it power d sigma. Okay, the absolute value how we define for the infinite place I have given, non-Archimedean absolute values are normalized according to the, so that the product formula is valid. So we are going to use the absolute veil height h of x. H of x is defined as a product of maximum of 1 comma mod x, I mean absolute value of x with respect to place omega, and omega, the product runs through all the valuation. Well, okay, all the places. Okay, so for a vector x in kn, x1, x2, xn, xi's are in k, and for a place place in MK, so we denote, we define a norm of this vector X, capital X, which is nothing but the maximum of the coordinates with respect to the place. Okay, the projective height is the product of the norms for over all the places. Okay, so now we are ready to state the periodic version of subspace theorem, which was proved by Evaste and Shilkivi. Okay, the version says, let K be an algebraic number field, M is an integer, any natural number greater than or equal to 2. Let S be a finite set of places on K, which contains all the Archimedean places. For each place, we get M linearly independent linear forms in M variable with coefficients in K. And what this theorem asserts that you collect the solutions set, solutions in KM, okay, you satisfying this inequality. This solution will lie only in the finitely many proper subspace of KM. That's the assertion. Okay, this has got a variety of application in many parts of number theory. What we are going to show is one of them part. Okay, so what we are going to prove We are going to prove that lambda, alpha are algebraic, non-zero algebraic numbers are given. P by Q is a rational number is given. We want to show that the trace of alpha, lambda, alpha power n equal to P by Q has only infinitely, no, only finitely many solution in n. Okay, that's the Diophantine equation we want to solve. Okay, so we are setting up the notation. L is the smallest field containing alpha and lambda. Trace, since trace map in field is a surjective map, L over Q, therefore, given a P by Q, there exists a beta in L such that the trace minus of trace of L, trace of beta is going to be P by Q. Okay, so therefore, it is enough to prove, since trace is of additive homomorphism, so therefore, trace of lambda alpha power n equal to P by Q, I am just rewriting in terms of this way. Trace of L over Q, lambda alpha power n plus beta equal to 0 has only finitely many solution in n. That's what we want to prove. Okay, this is the equation we want to prove. If possible, there exists in a beta. So we want to prove for any beta inside L because we have translated the Diophantine equation in this way. Okay. So we therefore suppose not, it means there exists one algebraic number beta such that this is violated. It means trace of lambda alpha power n plus beta equal to 0 has infinitely many natural numbers n. Okay, it's satisfied by infinitely many natural numbers n. So you collect those n's in as a collection of set as a set C prime. Okay. Let K be the Galois closure of L, H is the order of the torsion subgroup of K star, the usual notation as we were discussing in the preliminary. Okay. And since H is given, just since already we have infinitely many natural number n satisfying the equation trace of lambda alpha power n plus beta, adjusting n as a plus hm, okay, and we can get one infinite subset, subset C, which is subset of C prime, such that we there exists a in this one in this range 0 to h minus 1, such that the trace of lambda alpha power a plus hm plus beta is 0 for all m belongs to H. M belongs to this particular infinite subset C. Okay. So we want to get a contradiction. So how we are going to get a contradiction? Using subspace theorem, we will get a contradiction. Okay. In order to prove subspace theorem, we want to create a linear forms. So for that, we are working now. Let F is a intermediate field which is attached Q attached with alpha power H, which is a subfield of L because alpha inside L and alpha power H is inside L and it's a subfield. Sigma 1, sigma 2, sigma k are the embeddings of F from F to K over Q. Okay, for any M in that C. Okay, what we have is the trace is a trace of lambda alpha lambda times alpha power a plus hm plus beta is 0. That we are going to rewrite in terms of f also. Okay, that's what we are doing. This trace is a kind of tower, so we are just using the tower property. Trace of k over q, we can write it as trace of f over q of trace of k over f. So that's what we have done. So therefore, the trace of K over F of the elements, okay, this we are going to adjust this. You see the trace of K over F of some element, this means if this is lying inside F, okay, this trace is additive homomorphism, we just first separate. And then the alpha power H is inside F. Therefore, that will come out in this trace, first trace. Okay. So once that is coming out, the trace of we are going to use the definition of trace of some beta, so some gamma over F over Q. Okay, F over Q. That is some of the embeddings of that gamma. So that's what we have done in the second equation, in the second line. Okay. So first we are taking out the alpha power h outside the inside trace, and the outside trace we are writing the definition, okay, in terms of sigma is. And then we are separating it, since trace is additive homomorphism, we are just separating. Okay, we have got a kind of equation. We are rewriting this equation as, okay, what we have got is, okay, I am just going fast. So the last term, gamma, I'm taking, last term is nothing but sum of sigma is of trace of K over F beta. Okay, this is, I'm taking gamma. Lambda i's are nothing but sigma I of each term, trace of K over F lambda times alpha power A. Okay, by doing this, what we have got is, okay, this kind of, this plus, okay. The trouble was, I am not able to see, that's the reason I am kind of, okay, I'm skipping in some, okay. So, so what we have is kind of recurrence sequence. The lambda is are fixed, sigma is are fixed. What is going is only the exponent, variable is exponent only, okay. So the here the assumption is, case one is, if gamma is zero, what happens? Gamma is zero means the last term, addition term is zero. Therefore, we get a linear recurrence sequence for infinitely many values of m. This is the equation 10 we are getting. Okay, Wolfgang-Schmidt, one more theorem, what he proved is, this kind of linear recurrence theorem, this is called Skolem-Mahler-Leach theorem, which is again proved by Schmidt in this setup. Once you have such a linear recurrence for infinitely many natural numbers, what we get is there exist two integers, distinct integers I and j, such that whatever is the powers, okay, the sigma I of alpha power h, this is same as the xi times sigma j of alpha power h. It means the at least suppose if okay, so this is like beta 1 beta 2 beta lambda beta 1 power m plus lambda plus etc plus lambda k beta k power m. Suppose if we have, it says the Skolem Mahler-Leach theorem says that there exist two integer I and j such that beta I by beta j is nothing but the root of unity. Okay, so that's what it is saying here also. So sigma I of alpha power h is divided by sigma j of alpha power h is a root of unity. That's what it says in k. Okay. Oops. In k. Okay, so, but sigma i of alpha power h divided by sigma i of sigma j of alpha power h, this can be rewritten as sigma i of alpha by sigma j of alpha whole power h. This is nothing but root of unity. Okay, so this means that h is the nothing but the order of the root, number of roots of unity, that's the order of the Torsion group. Therefore, this psi has to be one only, because some root of unity power h is going to be root of unity. It means that psi has to be one. If psi is one, then sigma I of alpha power h is same as sigma j of alpha power h. But sigma i's are just embeddings from f to k. Okay, f is already these two are, I mean, agreeing on alpha power h. F is nothing but q times q attached with alpha power h. Therefore, sigma has to agree with sigma I has to agree with sigma j. which is a contradiction because we have taken all distinct embeddings of F. Okay, this means that this contradiction means that this case, the gamma has to be non-zero to start with this case. Okay, so if gamma is non-zero, then we have this equation, that equation will be looking like this. Okay, to finish the proof of the case two, what we have to prove, that we have to prove that there exists infinite subset, again infinite subset C1 of C, such that the relation, this kind of similar relation holds. The once again we can able to apply Skolem-Mahler-Leach theorem. Okay, this is the way, even though we have this, but we get another non-trivial relation of this form using subspace theorem. Okay, since gamma is non-zero, we rewrite this equation by dividing the both side of the above equation by gamma. Okay, so okay. So I'm just quickly going through. If S is a finite set of places on the number field such that alpha, the alpha is given to us, alpha is a unit, okay, it's inside the group of ring of unit group of the ring of S units. Okay, okay, so we can able to choose, I mean, again passing through, since C1 is an infinite subset, we can passing through another infinite subset if possible, if necessary, then we can able to make this assumption on one particular place, we can able to make this assumption, because only finitely many places are there, therefore one particular place we can able to make this assumption. Okay, so then we have to create the linear form. Using this equation, we are going to create the linear form. Okay, so the for the special place and one, we are creating this linear form, and the rest all just diagonal form. I mean, the if ith place means ith place variable only non-zero. I mean, rest all the zero coefficient. Okay, so this we can check that it is linearly independent or not. So final, the special points are what points we are putting. We are putting sigma 1 alpha h whole power m, and to up to sigma k alpha power h whole power m. This is inside k power k. I mean, k is a field and little k is the integer. This is true for all integer m inside C, that infinite subset. And one has to estimate these points are going to satisfy some this kind of inequality. That's the that is coming from what we have already, okay, some calculation. Okay, so this is, sorry, I'm just running out of time, that so I'm just pushing it fast. Okay, the points, whatever chosen points will satisfy exactly the subspace theorem, that inequality. Therefore, the using the subspace theorem, and what we can get is, it lies in the this, the points are very special points, like the x is like these points. These points are going to lie, after applying the subspace theorem, these points are going to lie in a proper subspace in k power k. Okay, it means that it lies in the hyper plane. Okay, so that's what it says. So that will give us a kind of similar to the case one linear recurrence for a subset, a infinite subset. Okay, so by case one again we get a contradiction. I'm sorry, this, okay, I'm done. Okay, so since I am traveling, I am using some different computer, it's completely messed up.